my God, this is my best birthday. Thank you so much. I am here at Oxford with this great people, with a smart student. I'm so proud to be here with you. Dear everyone, assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon all of you. And sorry, I'm going to speak in simple English. So forgive me with it if I made any mistake. Okay? Deal? Okay. Dear everybody, it's an honor to be at the Oxford Union, one of the most respected associations situated in the oldest, most prestigious university town of Oxford in the world. Today, I stand before you at this defining moment of history, when values of coexistence, community, democracy, and human rights are under threat. These are values that humanity has longed for centuries, until they were codified as rights in charters and constitutions in the first half of the past century, following two bloody world wars that claimed the lives of millions of people. Today, racism, hatred, and extreme ethnic conflict re-emerging among a wave of terrorism. This is sweeping the globe as if the world has forgotten past suffering and its judgment to distinguish between right and wrong. In the Arab region, the picture is much more complicated. In the post-Arab Spring era, counter-revolution flowing the Arab Spring are backed with the international support to crush people's dream for freedom and dignity and future, to crush people's dream for a better future. I am here to tell you the story of the Arab Spring, the dreams, the sacrifices, and the consequences. You might ask, did the Arab Spring fail? Did we betray the dream? Were we on the right side of history? Did we really need a revolution? Could we have avoided a bloodshed? The bloodshed? Was it a mistake thrusting our people in an unequal battle with the dictators and their international supporters? I am here to tell you. I am here to tell you about the rise of terrorism and extremism that is spreading violence and hate, about Islamophobia that has been used to delegitimize our peaceful revolutions and the peaceful struggle for freedom. I am also here to tell you about the situation in Yemen, my own country, about how a peaceful revolution that gained the world's respect turned into a fascist coup, how a militia took over the state, launched war, caused and continues to cause senseless destruction. I stand before you today to remind you, ourselves and the world, of our cause and hopes for which the people went out to the street during the Arab Spring. This is crucial memory. This is a crucial reminder at a time when the world seems to be quickly moving towards wars. International powers race to garner more devastating weapons to revive ancient imperial conflicts and intensify geopolitical tension between countries while marginalizing issues of democracy, human rights, and people's aspirations, and their right to choose their sovereign. Dear all, it is a universal responsibility to uphold people's right to elect their leaders and hold them accountable, to involve the people in the political process as full equal citizens who have rights and duties embedded in the Constitution, to build bridges and coalition between different countries, cultures, religions, sects, gender, and ethnicities. This is something that concerns humanity as a whole, not only the Arab region. As the famous saying goes, tyranny anywhere is a threat to freedom everywhere. Arab people are facing counter-revolution. You should know that. Arab people facing an ugly counter-revolution, threatening them with a darker future of dictatorial system. This threatens to destabilize the entire world and push us all back into darkness and violence. This is why understanding the political struggle in the other part of the world is no longer a choice. 6 years ago, peoples of the Arab Spring countries went out peacefully with their free will. They gathered in public squares, change and freedom squares, to put an end to seemingly endless despotism, eternal presidents, and hereditary republics. So, Arab Spring has declared. Arab Spring has declared that in this part of the world, there is a resilient aspiration to catch up with modernity, with the principles of democracy, justice, and human rights values. The Arab Spring has declared that the state must transform from being a tool of oppression that kills people and their dreams to a home where every citizen has a place, where every idea can be expressed and every dream can be fulfilled. The Arab Spring has declared that in this region, there are people dreaming to attain a genuine democracy that vanquishes corruption and transmits power peacefully, a true democracy, not one that masks a dictatorship, hierarchy, and unchecked power. Listen. Our revolution were not fleeting winds. Our revolutions were not fleeting winds, but rather they are desperate needs which we yearned for years, but were denied and crushed by tyrannies. This cry of justice, this cry of justice was the inevitable response to the decades of injustice, poverty, ignorance, and disease. It's inevitable response to the decades of corruption, repression, and state failure. Today, we are asked to make a false choice between security and democracy. This choice is presented by the dictatorship and the international powers that back them, under the rules of war on terror. Under the banner of war on terror, they seek to revive or recreate the collapsed dictatorship through fueling wars, coups, and sectarian militias. Failing regimes always exploit extremism and terrorism. They have derived international backing by claiming to fight extremism and terrorist groups. They claim that the Arab Spring has caused terrorism. This is ridiculous. Really, this is ridiculous, ridiculous. On the contrary, the Arab Spring has exposed how dictators use terrorism to tighten their grip over power and crush demands for democracy and human rights. They always threaten the alternative, that they always threaten that alternative is terrorism. So let me make this clear. Terrorism is not part of the Arab Spring or its revolutionists or its ideas. Terrorism is not part of the Arab Spring or its revolutionaries or its ideas. The Arab Spring aspires for human dignity, for justice, equality, and civil rights, and rule of law. The means to achieve these goals were peaceful. The means to achieve these goals were peaceful, and people were willing to give the ultimate sacrifice. Therefore, the Arab Spring was, is, and will always vehemently oppose terrorism because of a fundamental clash of values, goals, and means, and ideology. When we initiated our peaceful struggle and overthrow the heads of despotic, corrupt, and failing regimes, we inspired our people and offered a viable alternative to terrorism narrative. The Arab Spring taught us a valuable lesson that with non-violence, the journey to freedom is less bloody and more guaranteed. This lesson almost silenced terrorism ideologically and practically. And this is always what we have witnessed. In the first years of the Arab Spring, there wasn't even one single terrorist attack. Do you remember that? There wasn't even one single terrorist attack when the peaceful movement of the people had the upper hand. It was only when the crumbling and threatened regime sought to regain power by hijacking the peaceful movement, staging military coups against its outcomes, oppressing its people, and confiscating their gains through violent counter-revolution. So, again, our peaceful struggle was sweeping the whole community to defeat the ideology of terrorism. Our peaceful example was abolishing extremism's ugly practices. Our dream and goals march toward a brighter future, a future far removed from religious theocracy and fascism and toward the modern civil state. Our dream was that these principles be embedded in the constitutions of the Arab Spring countries. The revolutions and the revolutionists are peaceful. The dream is for freedom and dignity. The sacrifices are bold and reject resorting to counter revolution, to counter violence. This is how the situation was during the early years of Arab Spring, until the forces of coup and counter-revolution took over. And thus came the spring of terrorism. But I promise you, we promise you, this spring of terrorism will be autumn. This spring of terrorism will not last long, because our peaceful revolution are continuing and will win soon. We will keep trying. We will not give up. We will never accept to be ruled again by fear and cronyism. So let me ask you this question. And I always listen to this question. Who is responsible for terrorism? Don't you see that terrorism has become more of a brand? Who is fostering and marketing it? There is an obvious link between the betrayal of the peaceful Arab Spring on the one hand and the expansion of terrorist group on the other. When you establish despotism, you establish terrorism. When you establish despotism, you establish terrorism. Despotism and terrorism foster one another. Look at Syria and Egypt. The world's indifference to the military coup in Egypt and to Bashar's brutal suppression to the Syrian revolution have fortified terrorism. The Syrian regime's slogan was Al-Assad aw nihriq al-balad. Al-Assad or we will burn the country. We will burn down the country. And this is what they did. They slaughtered an entire population to save their dictator, to save one person. Yet, the international community was and is still silent toward Bashar al-Assad's crimes. This silence has given him permission to inflict brutality on his own people. The international community betrayed and conspired against the Syrian peaceful revolution. That is what brought terrorism and violence to the country. Let me remind you again. The Syrian revolution, like all the Arab Spring countries, started peacefully. But Bashar al-Assad rained down upon it bullets and brutality. He created a monster called Daesh, ISIS, to oppress the Syrian revolution, to deprive it from the international cover and support. Now, this monster has turned into an ideology that is spreading around the world and multiplying like cancer. Western catastrophic failure in Iraq. Western catastrophic failure in Iraq and disastrous invasion have fueled sectarian division and civil war. This is what happened. It left the country vulnerable to sectarian militia and Iranian meddling. This created conditions for the cancer of Daesh, of ISIS, and all other terrorist groups to develop and spread. So, dear sisters and brothers, when you are asked about the roots of terrorism phenomena in the Middle East, you may confidently say, it's because of the oppression and betrayal of the Arab Spring revolutions and the conspiracy against them by coup and counter-revolution. By supporting tyrannies and sustaining them with all means and tools of oppression, Daesh has come to life. So the biggest favor the world could provide to terrorism are propping despotism, blocking the mean of peaceful change, failing to support moderate religious group, and dealing with all as one size fits all. Here, and with the deep disappointment and rage, we say to all those involved in this sin, you have replaced the Arab Spring with Daesh Spring, unfortunately. They have replaced the Arab Spring with Daesh Spring, whether they did it intentionally or unintentionally. Not only that, they have also replaced the Arab Spring with the Spring of Iran's mullahs, who now control Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, and have expanded southward to Yemen, and is still expanding. The accomplices with coup and counter-revolutions have turned our peaceful dream into bloody nightmare. Massacres in Aleppo makes us cry deeply and mourn for a long time, not only for the mass killings of civilians by Syrian regime and its Russian and Iranian allies, but also for our loss of humanity. As we helplessly watched Aleppo exodus. Not only for the victim, we cry not only for the victims, but also for the failure to provide minimum protection to the weak and vulnerable, which is engraved in the collective universal human rights conventions and charter. Sadly, the international community saved the rest of the Syrian people by forcing them out of their homes and then hurtlessly watched them die in the sea, seeking refuge. What a pitiful achievement. What a shameful world. They have made a mockery of basic human rights and provided political coverage for this heinous massacre by celebrating what they have done and portrayed it as an achievement and a favor for the victims. Every day, new killers present themselves, yet some people blame the revolution, blame the victims. This is the logic of tyrannies. I believe that those who are to be blamed for the deterioration in Arab Spring countries are those who organized coups against the Spring Revolution, impede and oppress them, or through direct or indirect support to accomplish silence. Look at the course of events and evade all details. Check the stances taken by the neighbors, certainly you will find someone to point as accomplice who decide at this historic juncture to be at the wrong side of history. You will find, democratic government that claim to care for human rights, freedoms, and democracy, and reject any attempts to undermine them. Seeing to the situation in Egypt, Yemen, Libya, and Syria, and Tunis might be next, makes me feel that they want us to be stranded in terrorism or despotism, unfortunately. Seeing the situation in Egypt, in Yemen, in Libya, in Syria, and Tunis might be the next, makes me feel that they want us to be stranded in terrorism and despotism forever. Dear students, the maker of the future, you should know that peace within nations as important as peace between nations. And the people in my country and in the region from which I came are terrorized today by bloody dictators and by the international powers that back them. And they are abused by terrorist groups that misuse and abuse our faith. Every dictator in our region is a terrorist. Every dictator is a terrorist. And every terrorist is a dictator. And there will no path to the holy peace we aspire for until dictators are swept away from our region and terrorists are deprived from abusing our religion. Our belief in our peaceful struggle is stronger. We will build the state that we aspire, a state based on justice, freedom, democracy, and rule of law. Dear brothers and sisters, President Trump is trying hard to deepen the impression that Muslims are terrorists through his intensive statement claiming that the only risk threatening the world is the so-called Islamic terror. Whoever brands Muslims with terror is not only lying and ignorant, but he's also directly and indirectly serving the agenda of terrorists. Such hate speech makes it easy for terrorist group to decorate people and strengthen their ideologies while undermining moderate forces. Such hate speech makes it easy for the terrorist groups to recruit people and strengthen their ideologies while undermining moderate forces. But why wonder? Trump is a fanatic. And fanatics assist each other, regardless of their religion, nationality, or political affiliation. Yes, why wonder? Trump is fanatic, and fanatics assist each other, regardless of their religion, nationality, or politics, or political affiliation. How could anyone possibly describe an entire religion with 1.7 billion followers as a terrorist religion. How can anyone possible call Islam a religion of terror when Islam as whole religions is the religion of peace? When its Holy Quran says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا ادخلوا في السلم كافة. Oh, you who believe, enter into peace wholeheartedly. Wholeheartedly. Trump's policies against immigrants and refugees are discriminatory and racial, as they are based on identity and religion. These policies violate international human rights charters and covenant. These policies also conflict with the civil values that define the United States and the identity of its people. Now it is the time. It is the time to test these values and how they can survive Trumpism. The same applies to the extra-legal drone killing. Under the pretext of combating terrorism through drones that in many cases falls in civilians, women, and children. They are not combating terrorism. They are not combating terrorism. Rather, they are making and sustaining it with all means of survival and expansion. So, global activists, intellectuals, politicians, and the media, we all need to recall the inspired struggle of past heroes who fought for human civil rights. We shall continue the march now to challenge terror, the discourse of hate, and all other animosity and intolerance. We need to do that to save humanity from falling into the trap of wars and anarchy. We have to resist. We have to resist war within a global struggle that advocates for coexistence, love, and peace, and eliminate possibility of conflicts between Muslims and the West on religious ground, the way that Trump's administration is promoting. And remember, in our partnership in combating against terrorism and extremism, we shall not lose hope. And repeat the same zero-sum discourse. We will present our civilized discourse relentlessly, because we recognize that despotism and terror are two faces of the same coin. Feeding from the same swamp and sustaining each other. We shall combat despotism and terror together. This is our global partnership. We must fulfill it in all its complications in order to combat tyranny, support the forces of change, and dismantle terrorism by opening the door for peaceful reforms and encourage moderate groups, a moderate discourse, and an ideology of religious reform. So, those who ally with tyrannies, regardless of the justification, are not threatening values only. Rather, they undermine their countries, strategies, interests, because tyrannies pose risk to the world, not their countries only. Risks created by the tyrannies are transboundary. Therefore, combating despotism is not a local affair only, Combating despotism is not a local affair only. It is equally an international affair. Rulers will go one day. Rulers will go one day, but people will remain. Rulers will go one day, but people will remain. Reconcile with the people, not the rulers. With the liberators, not the oppressors. This is the only safe way. Others are mere delusions. Dear sisters and brothers, you may want to know what happened in my own country, Yemen. Well, in 2011, we launched a peaceful revolution to overthrow the dictator Ali Saleh's regime, who for 3 decades turned Yemen into a private property for him, his family, and his clan. It was a revolution against the state of corruption, cronyism, and failure. Our people who owned then more than 70 million pieces of arms, left their weapons and protested peacefully across the country. They faced oppression and bullets with roses and with bare hands. Regardless of the state's violence, they never responded with counter-violence. Millions of people gathered of change and millions of people gathered at Change and Freedom Squares for a whole year. The street became our home. Nonviolence was our strategy. We chanted, Silmiya, Silmiya, Thawratna, Silmiya, peaceful, peaceful, our revolution is peaceful. Until Saleh surrounded and handed over power. A transitional period started under the leadership of a consequences-backed president and government to lead the country into a democratic process within 2 years. We launched a comprehensive national dialogue where all stakeholders participated and worked for several months to draft a new constitution that held to the highest standard of freedom and human dignity. All stakeholders that held to the high, all stakeholders, including Houthis, including members of the party of the ousted president, were involved in the process. The referendum of the draft of the constitution was a few steps away. However, Houthi militia, backed by Iran forces, with alliance with the ousted president Ali Saleh, took over the capital of Sana'a. They destroy all things. They destroy the implementation of the outcomes of the national dialogue by sweeping with their arms through Yemeni cities, taking control of state institutions, spreading fear and chaos, and announcing the death of political peaceful transition. Houthi militia, or Houthi and ousted President Ali Saleh militia, imposed their own government headed by a member of the Houthi family and other senior officials. After the easy, shocking collapse of the capital, Sana'a's, into the hands of the Houthis, the militia faced resistance in southern and eastern cities, including Taiz, Aden. The country became an open war zone. Houthi coup, backed by Iran, didn't thwart Yemeni's dream change, but it has also defied all 7 UN resolutions that supported the political transition process, in addition to 2 other resolutions that rejected the coup and calls for immediate cessation. Western media has unfortunately underestimated the Yemeni issue. They only focus on the side of the story that involves the Arab coalition led by Saudi Arabia. Let me state this clearly. I condemn Saudi airstrike that hit civilians areas. However, the Western media, the Western activists have to also to report a war crimes committed by Houthis and the ousted President Ali Saleh backed by Iran. However, here from this stage, from the Oxford Union, I take the chance to call for sustainable peace in Yemen that is based on the following: an immediate ceasefire in conjunction with immediate and complete handover of arms, weapons from the militia of al-Houthi and armed group to the state. In conjunction with Houthis' withdrawal from cities that they took over. In conjunction with, after that, Houthis should transform themselves and declare themselves as a political parties that seek power through political means, not force or violence. With the procedures of the transitional justice that guarantee the right of victims and guarantee the justice. Then we can go to the ballots, to the vote, to make a referendum for the constitution, the draft of a constitution, the constitution that we already wrote. Then Yemeni people will go to the election. So, dear sisters and brother, you're here. You came to this university from all over the world, British and international student. Each one of you carries your own dreams and aspirations for a better future. In Yemen, following the coup, our dream has been destroyed. Young people, including children, are forced by the militias to take arms and fight in the war. People of the future are struggling again for regaining our country. However, as I said before, we will not give up. We will continue our struggle, our sacrifice, until take our freedom and democracy. So, the wheel of change has moved in our countries and will not stop before ending the world of tyrannies, oppression, prisons, pride, discrimination, and corruption. This hard labor will reveal the undersurface of the fake stability that has provided justification to trade freedom and democracy by the international order and superpowers that control the international orders. The Arab Spring has initiated a historic process that will not end by only removing the head of tyranny. It is a long process for reshaping our understanding of freedom, dignity, equality, state building, and to bring consensus to this new understanding. Facing the counter-revolution is just one step in the path of public revolution that has emerged a natural outcome of the turning wheel of history that seeks noon's permission, doesn't accept retreat, doesn't fear challenges or sacrifices. It is our eternal strive for freedom, rights, dignity, justice, and equality, as manifested in one phrase, Arab Spring. It's our eternal strive for freedom, rights, dignity, justice, and equality, as manifested in one phrase, Arab Spring. And so it has no Ottoman. No Ottoman. Rather, it is an everlasting spring for youth lives that have sparked 6 years ago with the first torch in Tunis. This is the law of life. This is the law of life. Struggle for self-esteem, rejecting injustice, and to adopt freedom, dignity, and human solidarity. At the end, glory to the revolutionaries who stood up for their dignity, freedom, and humanity alive, or martyred, or wounded, paid the ultimate sacrifices. Thank you so much.